Hi everyone, welcome to Shilpi's Academy. It is nice to meet you all via this virtual forum. I hope you are all safe and sound during this period. Friends, my name is Vigna. I will be handling your tax paper, meaning Group 1, 4th paper, tax laws. Let us see what that subject holds for us in the CS executive level. Friends, this paper is basically divided into three parts. Part 1, income tax. Part 2, GST. Part 3, customs, which is income tax for 50 marks, GST for 45, and customs for 5 marks. From the exam point of view, if I have to discuss about this paper is basically MCQ based for 100 marks. Will there be any negative markings? Yes, you will lose 0.25 marks for every wrong answers. Now, how should I go about this subject? See, before planning any subject, before planning to learn, before planning to approach the subject, first always understand what is expected from you. What is expected out of a student at this intermediate level, at this executive level. You need not search anywhere. It is there in your CS material itself. They have said that you need to have a working knowledge of DT, conceptual knowledge of GST along with the practical application of GST. They never want an expert opinion out of you. They don't want an expert knowledge out of you. Whatever is given, if you can understand the act and apply it, it is more than enough. They are not asking you to pass a judgment whether it is right or wrong. They are not asking you to read in between the lines. They are only asking you to understand. So how should I study this subject? Should I go mark based? Should I go with the lesson which has the highest weightage? Friends, sadly the answer is no. Don't go for mark based learning. Don't go for chapters with highest weightage, lowest weightage. It will not get you anywhere. It will never get you anywhere, seriously. Even after learning for 4 months, 5 months, you will always feel that you are learning less. So how to approach this subject? Simple. Like, you are able to read the slides, right? Whatever I'm putting up along with me, you are able to read the slides also. How? You went from your basics. You first learned the alphabets, then sentence making, and then you are able to interpret. Similarly, now you are going to learn ABCD in inter. Next, you will be learning to frame sentences in inter. After that, interpretation and playing, all these things will come in your final. So you cannot skip any chapter. It is a conceptual based exam. You need not by heart anything, friends. If you just read the subject and understand, it is more than enough. And moreover, it is MCQ. They are not asking you to, descriptively give an answer in 3 hours. No. If you understand it, you can apply it very easily. For example, let us take a simple example. The main problem with the students is they don't know what the subject holds for them. Basically, they are not able to view the chapter, view the entire subject as one. They see every chapter separately. They see every concept separately. So this problem arises with a lot of students who go for weightage marks, who think that, no, this is not my field, they're only law is my field. So let me just pass this, it's more than enough. So if you have that attitude, friends, let me tell you, please change it. You need this also. You are advisory people. You need to know everything, believe it or not. Okay. Now let us take a small sample. Okay. Income tax. This income tax has 5 headings. I'll just walk you through the syllabus later. Now I'll just tell you how to approach this subject. Okay. This income tax, mainly it has 5 headings. And all these 5 headings have something in common. 3 things, basically. 3 things in common. What is that? Chargeable. What is the income chargeable to tax? From that chargeable income, am I allowed to deduct something? Am I allowed to reduce that income? Okay. And is there any item which is inadmissible? Meaning, if I have to add something up. Basically, chargeable income less whatever it is allowed for you to, reduce your income to a certain level. And then the net amount is only charged to tax. If you remember this, it is enough. You can easily approach all the 5 headings, even in salary, house property, capital gain, other sources, PGBP, whatever you have, this condition holds good. You have something as chargeable income. You can reduce the income. You know, whatever is allowed in the act, you can deduct it. After that, whatever is remaining will get charged to the tax. Meaning the balance amount is one on which you will levy the taxes. Okay. See, I'll just give you an overall picture. See, if you take income tax computation as a whole, all the five headings together, what all you will have? First, you will have name of the person, assessment year, previous year, assessment year, the year in which, you know, the previous year is the year for which you are preparing the tax. The assessment year is the year in which it is getting assessed, meaning they'll see whether it is right or wrong or other things. Okay, I'm not going into much of details now. The address of a person, PAN number, and then your income tax computations will start. See friends, the part whatever I discussed till now, it is nothing but definitions. Name of a person, who he is. Is he an individual? Is he a HEF? A company? LLP? Who are they? AOP or BOI or whatever it is. That will determine what are the headings that will be attracted for that person under income tax computation. So all these definitions, assessment year, previous year, this is all dealt in the definitions chapter. Okay. Then if you come to salary head, you have always whatever you receive in your hand is chargeable to tax. So that income, chargeability is nothing but the income which you receive in your hand. And then, as I said, you there is something, some deductions are available from which you can reduce that income level. Say, for example, if I am earning 5 lakh per annum, I am allowed to reduce the income by, say, 15,000 or 20,000. And the rest 4,80,000 will only be chargeable to tax. So what is that? We have something called as entertainment allowance. We have something called as professional taxes. So who are all the people eligible for that? Then perquisites. What the employers give you for the job you are doing. If you take too much of deductions, then the income tax will ask you, boss, please stop. You cannot keep, you know, diluting your income so much. There is something which you have to add on it also. So is there any disallowances? Mostly the answer is actually no. In salary, you don't have much of disallowances and all. You only have allowances and you have perquisites. That's all. So the rest, whatever you have in your hand, will go to income tax computation. That is the only thing which is chargeable. Next comes house property. See, if you own a house, you get rent from that. That is chargeable to tax. That's all. So that is the income which is chargeable. So from that, am I allowed to reduce it? Say I am getting 10,000 per month as rent. So over a year, it is 1,20,000. I don't want to pay 1,20,000. I want to reduce it. So is there any chance of reducing that income so that my tax is reduced? The answer is yes. For that property, you will be paying municipal taxes, water taxes, and other things, which is deductible. And the government is also giving you a standard deduction of 30%. Why is the standard deduction allowed? See, there are certain expenses which you will be incurring for the property. If it is up to the assessee, see these definitions you will be learning in the second chapter. Assessee is a person who pays the tax. See, if it is left to the option of the assessee, he will tell, first, my income is 1,20,000, my expenses is 2 lakh. If you leave it to the individuals, if you leave it to you and me, we obviously want to reduce our tax limit, right? So we will tell my income is 1,20,000, my expenses is 2 lakh. So please, boss, I'm not ready to pay tax. So the government is protecting themselves. What they are telling is, I will give you 30% on your income for doing all your, you know, expenses job. Right? So that is a standard deduction for all your expenses. After that, whatever you have is the net income, which will go for chargeability. Next is PGBP, profit and gains from business or profession. Basically for people, anybody who is doing a business. Our starting point here is profit, because friends, the books which they have prepared, which the, you know, the company is preparing, it will be mostly company law based, accounting standards based, Ind AS based, and all these things. But income tax has its own way of computing the income. you cannot go preparing, you know, books for each act, right? So what we do, we take profit and we add inadmissibles. If the income tax says you cannot have an, you know, expenses for printing and stationery over 20% of your, you know, gross total income, in gross profit. From your gross profit, I will allow only 20% as stationery expense, not more than that. So the profit which is there in the books will be arrived after deducting the entire expense. So if 20% is allowed, 80% is disallowed. So I will add that 80% back. This is the basic concept actually. And you have certain declared items as inadmissibles, because in income tax, we have our own way of computing the depreciation. Under Companies Act, it has its own way of doing the depreciation calculation. So you cannot have a profit after the Companies Act depreciation. So you will be adding back Companies Act depreciation, and you will be reducing depreciation calculated as per the income tax. Okay, so basically PGPP will tell you what is admissible as, you know, expenses under income tax, what is inadmissible as expenses under income tax. Okay, this is a skeleton. See, once you know the skeleton, knocking the pillars is very easy. So for all the subjects, you prepare like this. Say the section, see the sections which come under chargeability. See the sections, what is defining the profit. See what is coming under admissible, inadmissible. List out that sections. Once you know only this much is attracting, then learning is easy, very easy. Then capital gain. Capital gain usually comes when you sell something, basically an asset, a very big asset which you are holding for a long time. Land, building, and all those things. Okay, shares. Shares is also treated as an asset under income tax. Okay, certain types of shares, holding period. Depending on the holding period, we classify it as, you know, right, whether it will come under short term, long term, and all those. We'll go into that things later. What is common for all the concepts? I am selling something, I am getting a gain. I don't want to pay tax on the entire gain. Am I allowed some expenses? Because to get this gain, I would have spent something. Obviously, I would have shared out my money for earning this much gain. So am I allowed to reduce that amount from the gain which I have? Yes. That too, you have certain rules and regulations for that. That's all. So what I am incurring for getting that sale proceeds, you can reduce. Obviously, purchase price, you have to reduce. Only then you can get the profit, right? So from the sale proceeds, you will be reducing the expenses, the purchase price. And then if you are allowed any deduction, you can reduce that also. After that, whatever is remaining, that will go to chargeability. Other sources. See, other sources will have, you know, anything which doesn't come under all the above heads will come under other sources. Your FD income, FD interest, savings bank interest. Okay, I deriving income from house property, but I maintain genset and all those things. I let out part of my property. So all these things, you know, I am a tenant. I am letting out my, you know, I am subletting it. So for the owner, it might come under the other sources and all those concepts. Basically, even here, to generate that income, you will be spending some expenses. Say, for example, genset income, generator income, and other, maintenance income. You are receiving under other sources. So if you are getting money for maintenance, obviously you will be spending some money for maintaining the job, right? Whatever it is, it might be cleaning, or, it might be keeping the place top notch because of this pandemic and all. You will be spending some money there, right? So you are receiving money from everybody for maintenance. You are spending that money on maintenance. If there is excess on that receipt, then it will be chargeable under income tax. Else, no. So you have to understand, you have to knock out every scenario and understand. So how that will come to you, only if you are conceptually clear, only then it will come to you, friends. after all these headings, you will arrive at one big chunk of figure which will tell, listen, this is the amount which is going to be charged for you. The moment you see the amount, you will get a heart attack. Am I allowed to reduce only these list of items? Do I have any other item which I can use it to reduce my income which is chargeable to tax, thereby reducing the tax which I have to pay to the government? Yes, that is discussed under deduction chapter. So after all these things, you have some ATC to ATU, you have a very big list. Okay, they say the scenarios and how much is the amount which is deductible. That's all. That's all. Chargeability, deductions, or items which you are reducing. Net income is chargeable to income tax. The final chunk on which you will be charging the income tax. Okay. And there is a concept called TDS. If you are a salaried person, see, for anybody, paying tax in one shot will be a difficulty. And that too, this comes in the next year. Your due date is July, your due date is September. At one shot, you cannot pay thousands if in case of a salary person. At one shot, you cannot pay lakhs and crores if it is in case of a company. So what the government is, you break your final tax into three portions, four portions, and then you pay it over the year. That is your advance tax. TDS is something which somebody deducts the tax on behalf of you and pays to the government. So when you add all these items, the final amount when you pay to the government, that burden, that shelling out of cash will not be much there. Because already throughout the year, there will be some portion which is, you know, taken from your income and paid to the government. So the final portion of tax will be less. So those things you can reduce. If you're not paying in time, if you're not paying your advance taxes and all, obviously the government is going to levy penalty. Here, they are just changing the word. They are not calling it as a penalty. They are telling it is an interest. The last amount, whatever is coming, is the amount which will be paying to the government. Now tell me, friends, was it difficult? Once you understand the skeleton, going inside it and knocking the pillars is easy. It is never, ever difficult. Are you understanding? And in this skeleton only, we will be seeing many scenarios. We will be seeing many cases. See, we will be having a spirited conversation only. We will not be telling, this is the format, stick to this format. You have to do this. It will never work. Don't worry. You have to understand. So here at Shilpi's Academy, we only focus on conceptual learning. We only focus on, you know, getting you the concepts crystal clear rather than, you know, by hearting it. By hearting it will not stay longer. You have to go to the field and practically apply it. So if you by heart today, fine, you clear the exam. If you don't have an understanding, how will you shine in your field? So we never encourage that, friends. Plus, we will be giving you a lot of question papers and MCQs to solve. You know, reality also comes in between, right? So we will be giving that exam point of training also. You need not worry about that. Okay, now let us see what is given in the syllabus portion. Now, whatever I told you, the incomes, exempt incomes, incomes which do not form part of total income calculation, which we saw, income computation under various heads, all these things form inside that skeleton only. Today, I did not list out the entire thing because the master data will be very big. I just wanted to tell you how to approach the subject. That's all. So I took certain things and I gave you a basic idea of it. Okay. And coming to GST, here also you don't have much of complexities here, so you can read easily. Okay, no much complexities is listed here. They just want you to understand the basics. They want you to know at what time the tax gets attracted, when should I pay the tax, and similarly how much I am allowed to reduce. from the final payment. Okay, just like income tax, how much I am allowed to reduce, what all documents should I have, what all maintenance, you know, maintenance of books of accounts, what all care I should take there, how should I maintain my books of accounts to align it with GST. That's it. And customs also, they are not digging in deeper. They have just touched the concept, you know, like drawback, import and export exemptions, administration of law, what are the procedures, warehousing procedures. There are separate procedures. Basically, they're talking about all the procedures only. What are the goods which attract customs? What is all prohibited? If you see your syllabus, if you see your part one, part two, everything, they are only asking the working part of the act. They never touch the expert part. No wonder in income tax, there is one. In income tax, you have this procedural compliance. Procedural compliance meaning what all you should comply if you are under income tax act. Say, for example, if a company is attracting section 177 of Companies Act, then they should comply with audit committee. Section 129, they should comply with the way the books of accounts are kept. Correct? You are company secretaries. You should be knowing all these sections in your fingertips. Just like that in income tax, what all compliance, what are all the steps the assessee should take? And some portion regarding the assessments, you know, types of assessments. If the income tax officer is asking me questions, what are the procedures I should follow? If the income tax officer is not happy with my reply, or if I am not happy with the judgment, who should I approach next? So can we go up to Supreme Court? In case we are going up to Supreme Court, what are all the cases? Right? And what if I do not follow the Income Tax Act properly? What is considered as an offense? You know, for you, it might not be an offense, but the act might tell, if you do such and such act, I'll treat it as an offense. I will punish you. What does it basically tell? They want me to file my income tax returns. I am not filing. I know the genuine reason. Say I might not be well. I might be out of country or something happened during the return filing time where I am not able to pay my income tax returns. I am not able to pay the tax to the government. So what should I do? Let me tell you one more thing, friends. Income tax paper, if you see it as a separate law, it will never go inside your mind. This practical applications you can see in your daily life. When you apply these provisions in your daily life, you can see that income tax is a part and parcel of it, and you are not learning anything new. Whatever actions you are doing, on that actions, whatever taxes is attracted, you are separately pulling it out and you are analyzing it. You are analyzing one part, one chunk of the economy. That's all. You can see it practically. And we will be having many case law discussions, many interesting cases, you know, the recent judgments and all in the class, which will make the subject even more interesting. Basically, we will be discussing. We will not be learning, friends. Thank you, guys. I hope to see you all for a spirited discussion in Shilpi's Academy. Bye. Stay safe.